Start. Sorry.
Yep. Ready
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Time Mastery in General Practice, preserving your most valuable resource. And we all know how valuable time is. My name's Tricia. I'm facilitating tonight, and I work at the Northwestern Melbourne PHN. I'm just struggling. I'm very sorry. I'm just struggling with my PowerPoint presentation at the moment, but here it is now. First of all, just like to do an acknowledgement of country. The Northwestern Melbourne Primary Health Network would like to acknowledge the traditional custodians of the land on which our work takes place, the Wurundjeri Woiwurrung people, the Boon Wurrung people, and the Wathaurong people. We pay respects to elders past, present, and emerging, as well as pay respects to any Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people in the session with us today. Just a little bit of housekeeping. This is a Zoom meeting. All attendees are muted, so please keep your microphone on mute. Please ask questions via the chat box. They'll be addressed during the presentation and at the end. The session is being recorded. Please ensure you join the session using the name you registered with so we can mark your attendance. It's pretty difficult to track down who's who if their name is iPhone 1. Certificates and CPD will not be issued if we can't confirm your attendance. We do endeavour to find out who everyone is, but sometimes time doesn't permit. This is how you change your name in a Zoom meeting. Now, you'll see there's instructions for an app, a desktop, and a Mac. So click on participants, click on your name or hover over your name, click on rename, enter the name you registered with, and click done, change, rename, depending on what sort of device you're using at the time. Certainly ask the question again if you're not sure how to do that. And Yvonne, who is in, who is helping us with the back end support, will assist you with that. Now, I'd just like to introduce our speaker, Dr. Todd Cameron. Todd is a general practitioner. He opened his first clinic in 2003 in Caroline Springs. He and his team grew modern medical to a network of 9 locations. He's a founding board member of ASX-listed BGD and later Zenitas. Todd switched from running medical clinics to conducting due diligence and saving owners from their own mistakes. As a founder of Scale My Clinic, Todd's personal mission is to give GP clinic owners their lives back and create financially sustainable GP practices. Wouldn't we all love that? He does this by helping members design better teams and systems which open the doors to excellence. Thank you very much. And now I'm just going to hand you over to Todd.
Thanks, Tricia. Thanks for the intro there. Now, if you have access to your camera, you're comfortable turning it on, that would be awesome. It's always better speaking to faces. I prefer the meeting setup to the webinar setup where you kind of don't have the privilege of looking at faces. However, if that's not your preferred option, then that's completely cool. Now, let me get to the screen share and I'll do a bit of a walkthrough of what we're going to be covering today. And before we get going, I just want to check that you all have the workbook. So just drop a Y in the chat if you have got the workbook. And you're going to need a copy of that, either printed out or if you're going to use it digitally on your iPad, that's cool. But you're going to need the workbook to do this session because this is a practical session. Roll the sleeves up and do some work. So drop a Y in the chat and then I'll continue when I know that you've got the workbook. All right, as you're looking for the workbook or making sure you've got that, and just put anything in the chat in regards to feedback. I'd love to know what your background is. If you're a GP, put GP in there. If you're a general practice owner, put GPO. PMs, just PM, and practice nurse, put PM. PN. If you're something else, then just put that in the chat as well. Good question, Sonia. I think you'll find that it was in that email, but we can probably drop you a link here for that as well. Okay, we're going to need to make sure that you have that. So what we'll do is just see if we're able to drop that there. call Sue Nettleton, a nurse. Thank you. Does everybody need the workbook? Are we able to, Yvonne, sorry to press on you this early, are we able to drop a link in the chat to the workbook so people can get that now?
I am. Is that something you supplied to Olivia?
I think they would have had the workbook itself. Give me one sec and I might
just looking through my folders.
Yeah, that's all right. I can open up. I can get link sharing turned on. And I can do that if you'd like me to do that.
Yep, that'd be great.
I'll just do tech support. Hang on 1 second.
Thank you.
Get link. Let me try this. All right, if you click on that, you should be able to access the workbook in the drive. Okay, cool.
Thanks, Todd.
I'll just give everybody a couple of minutes to get that downloaded and then print it off, or if you're going to use it electronically. A couple of names I know here. Hey, Joanne. All right, so I've just dropped the link in the chat. What I might need one of you to do, Yvonne, the chat is only visible at the point you join the webinar, so you might just need to copy and repaste that as we go. I'll make it a bit easier for people to get it. All right, and the rest of you, just drop in the chat for me what your background is so as that I know exactly who I'm speaking to. So GP, GP owner, practice manager, PM, practice nurse, PN or N, GP registrar, awesome, Sonia. Car, GP, excellent. Oh, good. GP registrar, Leah, GP owner, excellent. Tessie PM, Karen GP, nice. I'm just going to check that everybody has a copy of the workbook now. Just drop GTG in there, good to go, and we'll kick off. All right. That's all I like to see, Sonia. All right, so we're going to do a little bit of work with this. The purpose of this talk is to make sure that you can go away with something effective. So before we actually get going, what I'd love to do is just drop in the chat what you'd like to get out of this session. That'll help me a little bit with making sure we cover all the things you'd like to cover. Oh, nice, Kevin. Osteopath, welcome. Drop in the chat. What would you like to get out of today? Nice, Omar, registrar. This is such important work to do as registrars, you know, or early career doctors. I don't remember anybody ever having these conversations with me early on. And excellent, Sonia. All right. What we might do is do some specific work on consultation tricks when we get to the end. We won't cover exactly that in this, but we will do some work in here. Cool. Anybody else got some thoughts of what they'd like to see covered? All right, as we do that, I'm just going to give you a quote from Harvey McKay. Harvey McKay was a 15-time New York Times bestseller and an author, obviously. Time is free, but it's priceless. You can't own it, but you can use it. You can't keep it, but you can spend it. Once you've lost it, you never get it back. And unfortunately, we know this from our work as clinicians. You know, you'll often meet people that planned for more time, and that doesn't always happen. And so we do need to take this resource very, very seriously. Who's found that their life has become very task heavy, that the task list now is much longer than the pandemic? Who feels that that's been an issue for them? Just drop some feedback in the chat. this is interactive. You can't sit back and passively watch it like a podcast or something. And Karen, thank you for having your video on. Yeah, I think you're right, Leah, particularly as an owner. You know, it's been a really, really difficult time. And so it, not only is it task heavy, but often it's really spirit heavy. You know, that you leave the day feeling like something from yourself has been taken. And I think that's been a real challenge for us. Task heavy and spirit heavy in combination are really difficult to manage. And, you know, as well as those two things, we often find it's a decision dense environment. You're probably making decisions on more things than you were pre-pandemic. Put all of those things together and it substantially increases the risk of burnout. Who feels as if their approach to work has been negatively impacted in the last 2 years? Just drop that in the chat. Yeah, okay, Karen. All right, now I'm going to get you to give me a score for your personal energy at the moment, just between 1 and 7, 7 out of 7 being really high and 1 out of 7 being really low. Just a score for your personal energy levels. That will have cost quite a bit of money to buy. Good, 5, 4s, 3. Yeah, we need some, looks like there's some people that need some time out. Kevin doing well at 6.5, that's good. Sonia, yeah, most people are looking like they need a bit of time. And so what we want to do today is we want to turn things around. We want to have our system such that you can run to time and that you're going to do less work. You know, obviously, if you're going to run to time, you need to do somewhat less work. But if we do this right, that work will be better work. It'll be done better and to a higher standard. And then in the end, we're going to spend more time in our genius zone. That's what we really want to do. So let's get to the workbook, and I'm going to get you to open up to the page that says My Genius Zone, which looks like this. Now, in the middle of the workbook is the green zone, and I don't want you to write in there yet, but this in this zone, you can do it. My Apple Pencil's being a bit cantankerous, but let me try.
Yeah.
You can do it and you love doing it. So you can do it and you love doing it. And then in the next layer out, you can do it, but you don't love it. And in the one on the outside, it's possible. So again, you can do it. Get the tech working. Possible for you to do it, but you loathe it. So I'm going to give you 2 minutes. And what I'm going to get you to do is to actually go through what are the things that are in this zone for you, just in your regular daily activities that you can do and you love doing? What are the things that are in this zone where you can do it, but you don't love it? And what are the things for you that are in this zone? And I'm just going to give you 3 minutes to get through that. I'll just put a little bit of music on while we do. We've got 3 minutes going. And we'll get to doing that work. Try to just get down all of the things that you routinely do in your workday. And if you get extra time, you've got a little bit of time left, then certainly do the things that are in your private and personal life as well. Find love to max. What? Up in the studio, laying tracks. Burn it on the CD, melt the wax. And I'm feeling fine, because daily music's
what's on my mind. And I feel mellow when I watch the girl play the cello. Hello to all my fellow peers in here for the quality, music quality. Yeah, that'll be the focus and the topic of the day. So masterpiece like we used to say. Masterpiece like they used to say. Masterfuck like they used to say. That's my joint like we used to say. Syncopation, the true school way.
Going. Get Galaxy Note 10 Plus, which would have been an amazing prescient name if that was given to you by your parents at birth. But the Android system is not useful for the staff here at the PHN to know exactly who you are. So in order to rename that profile, you're just going to need to go to where your name is. There's usually three dots at the top of the box. Choose rename from that and then rename it. Otherwise, the team will remove you from the webinar. So if you're on a Galaxy Note and you're listening and you need to get going, then you need to change your name. All right, the rest of us. Now, what I'd love to do is just get a couple of shares in the chat as to those things in the red zone. You know, you can kind of passably do it, but you really don't like it. So put some of those in the chat if you could. The ones that you feel comfortable sharing. Remember, all of us like and loathe different things. There's no charge on whether you like it or loathe it. It's just that all of us really should be doing the stuff that we really enjoy doing in an ideal world, because those other things do suck a little bit. And so we don't want to be in that circumstance. So let's get a bit of feedback in the chat about some stuff you have in the red circle, the outer circle. GPMP and health assessment without nervous input. Excellent. Nice one, Karen. Simon chasing radiology results. Excellent. Good. What else? You spent a lot of time chasing that stuff up. Somehow Imran's overcome the muting, so I'll mute Imran. Happily, that wasn't a naked gun redo. All right, that's good. Let's get to the next bit of work we're going to do here, which is all around the value ladder. IT, yeah, Elizabeth, that can take a lot of time. Updating the address book in best practice, right, Simon? You know you can use the electronic address books in best practice, you know, which is updated by other parties. So you don't need to use your own one anymore. That's really useful. Kevin, yeah, I like that. Non-productive work stuff. All right, Simon, so you can change that in your settings and just make your preferred address book the electronic versions, which are run by others. And there are a couple of options there, so you don't need me to tell you. But yeah, start using those and your life will change. You won't have three or four entries for everybody. That is a really easy hack. All right, the next thing is the value ladder. And this is really important. It's kind of obvious, but often what I find is that people forget it. So if we look at a graph and we do two axes and we do value and then we do time on the lower axis, we'll see that they interact in a certain way. Now, This area on the right side is high value, and often takes us a while to get to the really high value work. And so, for example, the work you do in a consultation as a GP registrar, within 5 years, you'll be able to achieve more in less time, just because you're better able to connect with patients, you're better able to connect to the problem, and you're less likely to leave gaps in the way that you interact, okay? Just presuming we're all getting better in life. And so what we'll see up this far end is that this is super high value work. And this might just be doing all of the stuff in the center of that target, right? In order for us to do all of that stuff, we have to say goodbye to some things, okay? We have to say goodbye to the things down the bottom. So we need to start to sack some low value activities. And you put some examples of that in the chat. And Kevin, I'm going to challenge you to be really specific about non-productive work stuff. I want you to write down the actual things that come to mind and make sure that you have a list of all of those. So we're going to be working here on a framework that you can use to start to offload things. Now, there is a principle that we use in business, which is effectively called buying back time, okay? Who's heard of that? Just put some feedback in the chat for me. Right, I'm going to get you to put a number. And now, again, and these are, I just want to be really clear, this is not intended to be pejorative in any way. These top ones we're going to have as yellow, and then we're going to move into different zones. And depending on what job we have, the clustering here will be different. So what I would like you to do is to pick the rate that you get paid at for your best work at the top here. Okay, and if you're a GP, it's probably something like that. Now, some of you might think I don't get anywhere near that, but that's okay. We're going to pick a figure of $200. And in fact, I would argue it probably should be above that. But let's pick $200. And then we're going to start picking lower. And if you're a practice manager, that number might be more like $40. But we're just going to drop it each time a little bit further, okay? And, you can pick whatever gradients that you like. The reality is that some of the things that we do and some examples that were given there in the chat, I'm going to ask you, what is the price you would put on an hourly rate for chasing radiology results? What's that worth? Which box should that be in? Simon, where would you put that? Yep. It's in the red box, right? You could pay somebody $30 an hour, most likely to do that, and that will be fairly straightforward. What about the IT box? What about the IT problems? Whereabouts would you say that is for Elizabeth? Yeah, it's probably the lower green one. It's probably somewhere between 100 and 150, depending on what type of IT it is. Are you getting the idea about what we're talking about here, that there's a hierarchy here, there's a ladder, and that if you use the ladder, it doesn't actually matter what the number is at the top, okay? It doesn't matter what it is at the top, but below your ideal use of time is a bunch of stuff that you can actually begin to delegate to others. And we're going to walk through the systems for how you do that in a moment based on the buyback time principles, the value ladder. What I'm going to get you to do is to firstly put all the things in the top box, all the things that you can do and you should be doing. Just transcribe some of the key ones that you had above and stick them in that box, because now you're pretty sure those are the right ones for you to be doing. And maybe do the second box where you kind of do them, but somebody else could do them and possibly for less. Okay, so we're only going to work in the first two boxes right now. I'm just going to give you 2 minutes to put them in. So the difference is that this box is you. This box is ones that you could potentially give to someone else. But don't worry about who, because you're probably going to think I don't have someone else or I'm not sure who. Don't worry about who. Just worry about what it is that you would like to hand off to somebody else, and it could definitely be done at a lower pay rate than yours, okay? We're clear on the job. No thumbs back, but I'm assuming there are thumbs going up everywhere behind those screens. So I'm just going to give you 3 minutes to work on those top two boxes, and it's going to be you and someone else. All right? 3 minutes. Let's get going.
But you know what?
Top two boxes now. Get as much done in there as you can. Now, let's get a bit of feedback in the chat. Who found that useful in the first two boxes? Who got some really useful things? And I'd love to know, how many things did you get in the second box? Just a number. How many things were in that second box? Just the level underneath yours. Cool. Four. Nice, Karen. Get some more shares there. And as we're doing that, we're going to have a bit of a chat about the next bit. Actually, before we do that, let me go backwards. I apologize. We're going to do the bottom three, and I'm going to get you to do the bottom three at once, but I'm going to give you a little tip here that many, those of you that are business owners or have high earning capacity, there's a fair bit of space down here, and you can have home or personal jobs in these. They may be easier to delegate than some of your work-based ones. But, you know, somewhere in that $100 to $30 per hour, you should be able to delegate most of your home-based duties. Doesn't matter whether it's lawn mowing or cleaning, but a lot of time can be gained back from the areas below $100 per hour and typically below $50 per hour. Depends a bit on where you live, of course. But you might actually find some stuff. Imran seems to be able to unmute at will and outside of the walls of everyone else. I just muted again. And so I'll just get the team to keep an eye on Imran's profile, make sure that stays muted, please. So in this box between 100 and below, or whatever your number is, again, let's find out what are the things at these rates that you are currently doing. But I want you to go a little bit more broad than just business. What are the things that you're currently doing that you're going to actually offload to others, or you could possibly offload to others? Not going to, you could possibly have the opportunity to. And again, you don't have to know the exact prices. Just think, yep, I reckon that would be around about that rate. That's cool. Let's get 3 minutes to fill in those three boxes. With the music, you got the boom on with the funk. Whoa, you got the roll with the funk. It's gonna have a good time. Uh-oh, double L, rolling with the funk. It's gonna have a good time. Get on to a funky place. I'm going where? To a funky, funky place. I'm going to a funky place. Yes, I am.
In Budapest, my hidden treasure chest, golden grand piano, my beauty focus EOU. Ooh, you, ooh, I'd leave it all. My acres of a land I've achieved. It may be hard for you to stop and believe, but for you, ooh, you, ooh, I'd leave it all. Over you. I divide all. And give me one good reason why I should never make a change. And baby, if you want me, then all of this will go away. My many artifacts, the list goes on. If you just say the words, I'll up and run on to you. Adivido over you. Ooh, ooh, adivido. Give me one good reason why I should never make a change. Baby, if you owe me, then all of this will go away. Give me one good reason why I never make a change. Baby, if you owe me, then all of this will go away.
All right. Now let's get some shares. Who had some interesting things there? Who had some things that they hadn't thought about before that they might be able to offload? Again, there's no value attached to any of these things. It doesn't matter whether somebody else thinks they're important or not. They just have to be important to you. That's fine, Imran. Yeah, I'm not sure why either. That's okay. Technology sometimes doesn't do exactly as you'd like it. Let's get a bit of feedback about things that you found in the kind of the orange and the red zone. Accessible parking forms. Yeah, that's excellent, Karen. Good. Let's get a couple of other shares in the chat if we could. Yeah, so Karen, you're thinking that somebody else might be able to just have that delegated to them within the practice and could do all of the actual writing out of these forms. Perfect. Nice. All right, I know you had your video on before, so we might ask you for a little bit of a share about that, but later, if you're comfortable. Yeah, don't you love it, Leah, when, you know, the government says we're making something easier. Usually what they don't say, the little asterisk is easier for us, but it usually means harder for general practice because we now have to fill something in as a web form rather than coming out of our own software. You know, all the patient details and everything have to go in there. So it's great for them. We're doing all our admin work, but it takes us a lot longer. And these sort of things can be very, very frustrating. Yeah, as you say, they're not auto-populated by the software. Okay, cool. What we'll do is we'll keep moving just so that we cover off as much as we can what we're doing today. And the next bit is what we talked about earlier, stop, start, keep. Now, one of the key things here is that if you're going to free up space, you know, who feels like they're the sort of person that, you know, often feels like they have a lot of chaos or a lot of extra work in their life? Who can relate to that? Just drop a Y in the chat if you feel like, yeah, I'm always doing more than I should be doing. Yeah, look, I certainly, I'm better at this now, but I certainly used to find that I did this a lot. And then what happens is you clear something out. So you make some space. So I'm not going to be on that board anymore. I'm not going to be on that committee. I'm not going to be the secretary of that organization. I'm not going to be the treasurer, whatever. You decide you're going to clear something else out. And what happens when you do that? Just give me a bit of feedback in the chat there. Good, Joanne. You and I have shared a couple of boards, so we can relate to that. What happens when you clear out your time? What do you usually find happens? Feels like the internet is extra slow. Yeah, something else pops in there, doesn't it, Karen? You know, you don't usually find with people that are busy and are talented, what happens is the kind of level of chaos that you operate at, it kind of remains fairly stable. And over time, you might get surges and low points, but it remains at a fairly level point. So every time you get rid of something, what happens is something else kind of crops up in and jumps into the space. And so it's like there's a bubble of a fixed size, and it's just a production line. When you get rid of stuff out that way, more stuff comes in the other end to actually fill it up again. And so what we're going to do here is do our best to build some constraints around our time because of who's heard of something called the Peter Principle? If you've heard of it, put the definition in the chat there. Put the definition in the chat for me. Work expands to fill the time available. Exactly, Sue. Exactly. So we want to, because of that, and that's true, of course. Does anybody here dispute that before we go on? Does everybody accept that that is a true principle in everything they've observed? And this works, you know you've got a lot of time to complete a little bit of work, it's very rare that you get it done in less time than the time available. It does expand to fill the time available. So what we're going to do here is we're going to build some constraints. We're going to make sure that we let's mute that profile. We are going to make sure that we build some constraints into the system to stop the work expanding to fill the available time by prioritizing. So this list is called a start, stop, keep. Who's done this in their clinic? Who's done this in their clinic? This is a great job to do in your practice because you can just get a bit of butcher's paper on the wall and just have three columns, one, two, or two in the middle, and then just have start, stop, keep, and get everybody to get out their post-its write out their ideas, all the things that they're doing, and ask them, you know, what are the things that you need to start, stop, keep? Now, the purpose of this is there are some things that you know you should be starting. They might be personal things. They might be health related. They might be, you know, related to your diet. They might be related to your lifestyle. They might be related to your social network. They might be related to connection. They might be related to your spirituality. There are some things that you might have to start doing that you know in here that you need to do, and it maybe irritates you that you don't. And then there are some things that you do that are not useful at all. Maybe that's playing Candy Crush. Maybe that's sitting watching TV more than you'd like. It may be watching Twitter implode with Elon Musk at the helm. It could be lots of things, but the things that you know that you really should be stopping, not because they're in any way bad as such, but just because they don't add value to your life. They aren't things that you really intentionally took on. Sometimes what happens is you kind of adopt a habit that just kind of seem to appear, but it's not really constructive, doesn't serve any of your overarching values or goals, and it just is routinely done. And then there's a bunch of stuff that you are doing and you really want to keep it, okay? Now, this can be work and home. That might be, you know, playing basketball, netball. It might be some sporting activities. It might be some leadership activities, coaching your kids' teams. It might be some work activities that you love, but there's a bunch of stuff under keep as well. So what we're going to do first is the start and the stop ones. So what are the ones that you need to start and what are the ones that you need to stop? Now, I want you to write without thinking too much. I know that sounds really weird, but what I want you to do is just get as many things out as you can that you would like to start. This is the stuff that you probably saved for January the 1st. But I want you to do it right now. And the stuff that you need to stop, you know, you probably know what that is. And if you're not sure, go and ask your partner afterwards, because they will probably give you a large list of starts and stops, and you'll have to work on your own keep list. We clear on the job? All right, let's get you to do that. I'm just going to give you 3 minutes to do those two columns only, okay? So we're just working in these two boxes now. I'll give you 3 minutes to do that work.
My friends and family, they don't understand. They fear they'll lose so much if you take my hand. But for you, ooh, you, ooh, I'd lose it all. Ooh, for you, ooh, you, ooh, I'd lose it all. Give me one good reason why I should never make a change. Baby, if you owe me, then all of this will go away. Give me one good reason why I should never make a change. Baby, if you owe me, then all of this will go away. My house in Budapest, my hidden treasure chest. Golden grand piano, my beautiful Castillo, you, ooh, you, ooh, I'd leave it all. Ooh, for you, ooh, you, ooh, I'd leave it all.
It's going down, I'm yelling timber. Remember, I'll be the one you won't forget. Swing your body.
let's get a bit of feedback as to how many things you got in those two columns. I'd love to know the number of things that you are able to get out. So just count up, start and stop column. And how many did you get in total in the start and stop? Simon, for you, one of them is stop using the address book and go to the digital address book. Let's get some numbers there to see how people have gone with. More in start than stop. Excellent. That's really cool, Elizabeth, because it gives you a really compelling reason to start paring things away and adding the things that you know you need to do. Sometimes we're sitting there giving advice to patients or helping out people in the clinic environment, and we're actually not doing the things that we're talking about with others. So that can mean that we feel terrible because we're lacking integrity in that environment, not because we lack integrity, but because we lack integrity with our actions and what we would like to do. So it's really, really important to make sure that there's alignment there. All right, what you want to do now is go to your keep list. And the keep list is just the stuff that you know needs to stay. Now, be really broad here. This is in your life more broadly. This is not just about work. So this is the stuff that you actually need to keep. The things that you know you need to keep, you like doing them, so they're not spirit heavy or task heavy things. You know you need to keep doing them. So make sure you get a good list of the keep. I'm just going to give you 90 seconds to do that. So we're just going to go through the keep list now. But this is broader than just work. This is in all of life. I'll give you one example of things on the keep list for me. I have three children, 18-year-old daughter who's doing VCE right now. Those of you that are writing, just keep writing as I'm talking away. A 15-year-old daughter is in year 10, a 12-year-old son. I coach one of my son's basketball teams and help out with the other one. Coaching 10, 12-year-olds at 7:30 on a Thursday night is not particularly life-giving activity, but it's really important to him, and so therefore it's really important to me. So that stays on my keep list, even though I might find it a little bit of a drag at times. It's paid off on game night when you see the kids do something they haven't done before. I'm not too fussed if they win or lose, but I do enjoy seeing the kids progress. So for me, that would stay in the keep list because no matter what, it's going to remain there.
Club jumping like LeBron now. Bowl it, order me another round. Homie, we about to clown. Why? Cause it's about to go down. Swing your partner round and round. End of the night is going down. One more shot, another round. End of the night is going down. Swing your partner.
All right. Now we'll get back to our next one. Who had something they would like to share from their keep column that they thought is pretty cool? Who has that? Learning a second language. That's awesome. One that you plan to use with travel, Leah, or is it just for your academic interest? Cool. German. I like it. Excellent. All right. Has this been useful so far? Just drop a Y or an N in the chat. I'm okay with the N's. Yeah, Saturday Sport for the Kids, Simon, is fantastic. Cool. Okay. We've got a few more things to add in there, and then we'll come back to consults and we'll do a little bit of work on that. as a separate matter. All right. So what we're going to get to now is delegation mastery. And I will do this at the end of this short teach, Karen. If it's okay, I will ask you for a little bit of feedback on what this was like compared to the way that you did your delegation. Anybody else feel that they are a delegation master? If they are, just put DM in the chat. Or it should be an MD, hey, a Masters of Delegation. All right. Now, when we get going with a project, and I'm going to use 6 weeks because we coach projects in, we coach people in how to deliver projects as part of my coaching to practice owners. And this is a common problem that we delegate something and it's not done particularly well. I'm going to ask you, what is, I like that, Elizabeth, an MD in the making. What is the total amount of projects, if they are 6 week projects, what's the maximum number of projects you should take on at any one time? Just put that in the chat for me. And as you do, I'm just going to show you my concept. This is a concept that was, I was chatting to a good friend of mine, Simon Bowen, about. And he's kind of been the person who's created this graphical representation of it. But good, Karen. 3. Any other thoughts on that? 2. Yep. Well, I'm liking this. This is good. Now, the real answer to this is 3 is the maximum. You are right. We don't let people take on more. However, what I find doctors do in particular as A-grade overachievers and practice managers are put in the same boat because they're so used to being busy, what happens is they try and sneak a couple of more in and call them something else, pretend they're not projects, right? Now, your energy level for you and your team should drive this. So 3 is only permissible if people are a kind of 6 or a 7 out of 7 for energy. If they're a 4 or a 5, it really should be 2. If they're below 4, I would think carefully about whether you do one or not, but you might put 1 project in there. It is much better to do less and then have capacity to add something after you've achieved it than it is to underachieve on all fronts, okay? That's really, really important. Don't burn your team out just because you have an ambition to do a lot more. That's really critical. All right, so when you set out to achieve a project, or to do a job, there are only 2 options, that it either succeeds or it fails. Do we agree on that? There's not really a middle ground, is there, where you kind of part succeed. You know, we might convince ourselves that there is, but there isn't really. It's 2 options. And so you're either here where, you know, you succeeded, or at the end of the period of time, you're here. Now, when you meet with your team, this is the most valuable period of time. In the first week or so, the first 20% of any project is where you should be giving a very, very good brief, okay? When you are delegating something, you need to give a brief, and that brief needs to include the definition of done. So it would tell the person, this is really important, it does not tell them how, it just tells them in great detail what is to be achieved, okay? Just what. So for example, I talked about Elon Musk earlier, and I'm going to pretend I'm Elon Musk for a moment, in a sane moment, and I'm going to talk about I'm creating the next Tesla, maybe the Tesla Model S Plaid, and I'm going to say to the engineers, it needs to have a range of 600 kilometers. There needs to be able to go from 0 to 100 kilometers in 2.2 seconds. And it's got to be better riding than, you know, the current leader in the class, Mercedes or whatever it might be. And it needs to be able to go around the Nürburgring in under 7 minutes. So those are definitions of done. He's not telling them how to do those things, but he's specifying the end result in fairly specific detail. So it's really easy to know whether somebody achieved that goal or failed. You know, if it doesn't make it, all of those specifications do not come true, then they keep working on the project until they do come true. Does that make sense? Put a Y in the chat if that makes sense. So we need a definition of done, but no how. This is really important. Because We love to delegate how. We like to tell people how to delegate. The problem with that is we can only ever be as good as ourselves. And whilst we might think we're pretty good, everybody else, the wisdom of all of the people is much greater than you. None of us is smarter than all of us, really simply. So the only time you can contribute how is when you know there is quicksand, okay? And so that's not actually a how. That's a not how. Okay, so for example, you might delegate responsibility for the backyard. And this is a Stephen Covey story from his book, The Seven Habits of Highly Successful People. He, in the book, Stephen delegates to his kids to look after, one of his kids to look after the backyard. And the job was green and clean. So he kept the lawn green and make sure the backyard is clean. Didn't work particularly well the first time he did it. But one of the things he said is you cannot paint the grass green. So, you know, you kind of know that there might be a shifty way of doing it or a way that ends up causing a problem with compliance or regulatory issues. So you need to specify if there are areas where people should not go for any reason, you need to make sure that those are covered off on, okay? And then in the definition of done, you're giving all of the specifics. Now, what I say to people after that is you do not interfere with the person that you have delegated the project to. You do not interfere with that project at all. You don't touch it ever unless you were invited to give help, okay? Now, what I'm going to tell you is that you don't fall off the green line, okay? You behave yourself. Off the green line. So anybody who's had a goal like I want to get fit and healthy will know this really well, right? It's that they'll have a habit of doing the things that they said they'll do for a while, and then their behavior starts to fall behind and they start to not get the results that they're wanting, but they're not doing the behaviors. Then they get frustrated and often fall right under the red line and then declare they're going to do an even bigger job and go back and try and get on that green line again. So this cycle is a cycle all of us are used to. Now, when you check in with that person, how frequently would you usually check in on a six-week project? Just drop that in the chat for me. Perfect, Karen. Weekly. Yep. Nadia, good. Weekly. Exactly that. Now, when you do your weekly check-in, like you can see here, one, two. So at one, you're giving the brief and you're making sure that during the brief that people have an opportunity to ask questions if they need to. Now, if something happens where they're off track, so they're down here and they're saying, I'm off track. What I prefer is to say, book some time to interview me. Okay, so you don't want to go in and start doing things, which is sometimes the temptation. You just say, put some time in my calendar. It could be a half an hour block or it could be a 1 hour block. I prefer irregular times, 20 or 40 minutes. And the reason for that is, again, the work expands to fill the time available. I would prefer people come in, they have a really good brief and they ask really specific questions in there, but their job is to interview you in order to overcome the barrier, the obstacle that they have found. We good with that? We clear on that? Okay, so the interview. If they do not ask for an interview, and when you do your weekly checks, you say, are we on track or off track? Right? Only one question, on or off? And if they say on track, your response is, are you 80% or more certain that you are on track? Are you 80% certain or more that you are on track? If they say yes, then they are accountable for the outcome. If they say no, then you say, okay, book a time to interview me and we'll discuss the barriers and obstacles that you have at the moment. Now, the barriers or obstacles could be created by you. What type of barriers or obstacles might you or the clinic be putting in place that are getting in the way of a project being delivered? Yep. The brief not clear. Sometimes it's, yeah, Karen, you've nailed it. Not enough protected time is a very common one. You keep dragging them in different directions. Yeah, competing demands. Excellent, Sue. Yeah, particularly if they are synchronous, if those other things are occurring at the same time and distracting. Distractions are awful. I asked this question at a conference I was running on the weekend. Asked people in clinics who has more than 20 distractions a day. The number of hands that went up was shocking. And the evidence is pretty clear that it takes you 15 to 20 minutes to restore full concentration following a distraction. So if somebody's distracting you, or if you are being distracted at work 10 times or more, you are probably never, ever deeply concentrating on anything. That's pretty horrifying, but true. So we need to make sure that all of this is around reducing distractions for people. So every week, you're just doing a check-in on the project. So you're saying, you're not asking them for how far along they are complete, because it's kind of that's kind of rubbish in its work in progress, in that we never really know how much of it's in progress. They know the due date. So the question is, are you on track and will it be delivered on time? And if they say yes, then again, your next question is, are you 80% confident or more that you're on the right line? Yes. Now, people will fail this, okay? And that's okay, because learning about accountability is part of what you're trying to do with people. But what you are also delegating is, you're delegating the decision-making as well. What we sometimes do is say to ourselves, well, I want to make sure I'm across all of the decisions, so I want you to bring those back to me. But you need to pledge here and now that you'll delegate decision-making responsibility to people, or you will always be the bottleneck and that person will never, ever fully be accountable for the outcome, the results. Clear? So let's make sure that we are responsible for that. There's a really good document that will help you with this, which is called the Dan Sullivan Impact Filter. I don't have anything to do with that, but just write that down. Go searching for it. You'll be able to find it for free on the internet. It's a fairly self-explanatory delegation document that is written. And what I usually do is write this, and then I'll usually give what we call a loom, a video that goes on top that just explains how it is that you use that. And I'm going to go through that in a moment. Now, Karen, I'm going to ask you, how different is that from what you do? What upgrades have you got that you would suggest? And I'm just going to see if I can get you to unmute. Hang on a second. Ask to unmute. You've got my permission now.
Sorry, can you repeat what my task is?
So you were talking about that you delegated something earlier.
Yes.
And I was keen to get what framework you use, what kind of approach worked, and just to hear from you if there was something you wanted to add.
Well, I don't think I did anything really clever. I didn't have a framework. I just figured I'm probably into thinking about a bit of delegation in general. So, you know, especially when I find some tasks tedious, I'm very much of the mind that, you know, what's that Americanism? You should work at your, what do they call it? Work at your license. That's the terminology they use. So, so that's forefront. I suppose that might be a framework. I don't know. But anyway, so with the accessible parking, as it's called now, was called. So it was really to delegate that to a non-clinician, so not the nurse, somebody who helps us with chronic disease management in general. She's got a very good understanding of processes in general practice because she's been with us for probably more than 5 years. Mm-hmm. And she actually has done a health degree, but not a clinical degree, health sciences, I think it was she did. Mm-hmm. So she's got some understanding of health things,
Cool.
So, she just kind of has not had any problem doing that when you sort of gave the framework of what she needed to do.
Fantastic. And the next question is, what else could I delegate?
Yeah.
That's exciting.
keep working.
Thank you. Appreciate the share.
No worries.
And now I want to just remind you that with this framework here, the green and red lines, the closest they are together is at the start. The more the gap increases, the more you behave yourself off the green line, the more aggressive your restorative surgery must be. If the lines are far apart, you need to be very aggressive to get something back on track, which is why it's really important to have the weekly check-ins. And this should ideally be a part of your weekly meetings, so as that you know that things are on or off track. Okay. All right, let's get to the next thing, which is getting on to some superb systems. Who feels that they have great systems in their practice? Just drop a yes in the chat, or actually put me, because you can you know, give yourself a bit of a pat on the back for this. And then we'll do a little bit of work on the consult. I was going to do breakout rooms, but I don't like doing breakout rooms when we've got profiles with no video on, because you could end up in a room with a bunch of dead profiles with people watching TV or doing something else. And that's very frustrating. So we won't do the breakout rooms at the end, just for Yvonne. Yeah, Karen. Okay, I'm going to give you some simple ways of improving some systems. All right. So the first thing we're going to do in our workbook is pick a system. Now, you'll notice here that it has to say built and used, okay? Built and used. So if you have a system that's built but it isn't used or it isn't followed, then it's not really a system. So I'm just going to get you to get out five things that should be systemized in your practice that come to mind that are kind of bugging you. So just get five things up, and it might be that a system exists, but it's not particularly well done. Okay, so I'm just going to give you 2 minutes to fill this in. Let's do 2 minutes. Let's make a night you won't remember. Start with five systems. That would be okay if they got five systems right. Now, I know that at the moment, some of you are converting from bulk billing to mixed billing, or you might be shifting patients that you currently bulk bill onto a private billing model within a mixed billing clinic. And so one of the systems that you might need to improve is payment. You might need to improve payment systems. And the systems need to be built and used. So that means that people need to get it, want it, and do it. Okay, get it means they have the knowledge. Wants it is all about alignment and purpose. And do it is all about motivation. Okay, you've got to get it, want it, and do it. And so in the built and use, just put some features in there that are going to be necessary for making sure that that system is built and used. And I'm going to give you a resource here that you can record, as in write down, called Loom, which is screen recording. Jeez, my pen's nearly at the end of its life, I think. Loom is the video which screen recording software, so it can do video plus camera image, or it can do camera alone or screen alone. So that is the best tool for recording exactly what you're doing. So for example, it was about payment systems, and some of it was the stuff that was on the screen, then you'd use the screen recording part, and if some of it was how you're using the Tyro terminal, you just show the video of you doing as you verbally narrate what you're doing. And you're just going to do a quick and dirty recording of that system. So you're going to do here, what are the features that are need to be built for it to be used? What need to be the key elements of it? And then what are you going to get started with? What's the first thing that you're going to do? Okay, because I want to make sure you guys have these and you go away and you do something about this, because a concept is not useful, but an action is useful. If you want a different outcome, you've got to think differently and you've got to do differently. Fairly obvious. So I'm going to give you 3 minutes just to do the built and used and the get started with. Okay. Let's do both of those. Let's put some things in there for it to be built and used. You know, you might have something about access on all of the workstations that it's relevant for. So that might be your reception team. There might be a QR code at the front desk where the staff can find it as an open access tool, or there might be a search function within your intranet to find it. It might be incorporated in weekly training for that team just to make sure the system is built and used. And what's the first thing that you want to make sure that you get done with it? There's probably only, your clinic will have about 180 systems in total, but there's probably around about 15 to 20 that are your critical systems that you're kind of working and using 85 to 90% of the time. So the last bit is a lot of systems for unusual things, but the key stuff is usually only 15 to 20, so it's not a lot. Does anybody here use Loom already?
Wake up, wake up, wake up. Oh, baby, now let's get down tonight.
All right. Now, I'd love a few shares as to what systems are important to you to get right. So what did you score as your top five? What's on the left? Just drop some of that in the chat. And as we do that, I'm going to give you a couple of principles on consultations. And this is some work I do with registrars. Awesome. Yeah, Karen, repeat prescriptions are a really good one. Pharmacists don't tend to tell people that they need to get the repeats from them, so people ring the clinic and ask for them. So, yep, that's a good one. You can include that in your incoming voice messaging as well for the phone. Cool. Okay. There's some good ones there to get on. So with consultations, those of you that are clinicians, one of the biggest problems is people expectations often aren't realistic for the amount of time and expertise that we have to offer them within that time. So it's really important to do a pre-frame, and the parts of the consult that make the consult succeed are, many of us are good at doing the consult, right? They do this bit well. But I think this is like, when you look at the underage kids sport compared to professional sport, there's a big difference in the quality of the outcome. And the difference is not what happens on the pitch, all right? When they both go out on the pitch, they both endeavor to work their best out there. But the difference is what happens before they go on the pitch and what happens after they come back from the pitch. You let the kids out there, they tear around, they do the best that they've been trained to do, but often the training is not particularly broad, and often it's not particularly focused on, set plays and things like that, for obvious reasons. I'm not suggesting that necessarily that's appropriate for kids. But we do need to do the same thing as elite sport as we do in consults. And if we have a 15-minute consult, the pre-consult is probably somewhere between 1 and 2 minutes. And you might use a tool like DCP or TopBar to help you, because they reference the RACGP Red Book guidelines. So you have somewhat of an agenda before the patient comes in, and you'll also know whether there are any opportunities to do, things like a care plan review, whether they're due for a mental health care plan review, etc. There's things that will tell you that are around about the MBS items that are available for them, but also it's going to talk to you about interactions, etc. You're going to look for medications that are overdue. You're going to look for any pathology results that have come back in the interval between the last visit and this one. Likewise, any letters from any non-GP specialists. There's a bit of stuff you'll do in that first 1 to 2 minutes where the patient isn't in the room. And then at the end, this bit's usually only a minute. The bit at the end, though, is really important. Did you require a medical certificate for today? Do you have all your prescriptions, your referrals, any paperwork that is required to be filled in the interval between this and the next visit? We've done some research on this. If somebody walks out and calls the clinic from the car park and you've already taken your next patient in, it's probably 20 to 30 minutes of combined work to try and rectify the things that they forgot about asking for, okay? And this should also be where you talk about e-scripts. So this is coming back to your point, Karen, is you just have everybody do this at the end, and you can put this checklist on the back of the clinic door. So when the door's closed, the patient sees it, and it just says, do you require any repeat prescriptions? Do you require any referrals? Do you need any certificates? Remember, e-script repeats come from your chemist. Okay, so it's a fairly brief checklist. And then the other one is, do we need to make another appointment for you? What that means, though, is this time here is actually more like 10 to 12 minutes. Okay, so you need to start educating your patients that the time available for consultation is 10 to 12 minutes because we do these other things. The pre-consult takes place without the patient in the room, so you can get your head right for what to expect when they come in. Is this a recall? Is it a recall for a reason? Is it an unexpected visit that you don't have any context for? Is it a planned visit and so on? Is it specific to a health assessment care plan? And then you'll do the actual consult. And obviously during the consult, you're understanding what the patient needs are and weaving your own needs in there, not necessarily in that consult. You might say, hey, you're due for A, B, and C. I'm just going to give you a pathology form to go and do that. And we'll make another time to catch up and go through these interventions. And then at the end, making sure that you routinely go through that checklist will save you probably half an hour to 45 minutes per day. I'm going to ask, does anybody do this? The last thing I'm going to teach you about, and then we'll finish up, is something that is useful for registrars. Cool. That's excellent, Karen. The pre-consult is probably the most valuable, the post-consult. So the patient's in the room for the post-consult, and I would say to them, the consultation is finished now. I'm just going to go through a checklist to make sure we didn't miss anything. Would that be okay with you? I always say yes, and then we get to that consultation list. Now, one thing we do badly in medicine is set expectations. And so we often end up doing this thing that I call the wedge. I'm really keen on the registrars here offering feedback on this. Now, I've got the amplitude of my bars wrong. I know that's a first world problem. Okay, so who has had an experience where a brand new patient to the clinic comes in for a 15-minute appointment and they clearly have expectations for a one-hour consult? You know the patient. They've got radiology films, specialist letters, big bag of medications. All right, Leah. Yeah, it's very traumatic, isn't it? And it looks like this, right? So the first consultation really sucks. Second one, third one really suck. And then it sort of starts to get a little bit better as you start to regain some control of this patient. And then you get to consults that, you know, maybe after about 3 to 4 months, they're kind of relatively okay. I would propose a completely different model to this, because what happens, the response of most clinics is to say, we're going to offer 30-minute appointments for new patients. And then what happens as a result of that particular change? Just drop that in the chat for me. Yeah, they never come. Exactly. Right. And so you end up with a day where like three new patients don't attend, or four, and you've lost an hour and a half, 2 hours of consulting. So I recommend that you don't offer 30 minutes to new patients, that you offer 15 minutes. And you use a trick I call wedges to diamonds. So the first consult is intentionally brief. You say, it's great you bought everything today. We're not going to look at one piece of that. I just want you to tell me my story. Yes, Simon, have a cold only. Yeah, exactly. That's exactly right. Or something else that doesn't require the full 30 minutes. And they get consented for a level C. It's just all a bit messy. The first consult should just be to get to know them. And in fact, in many cases, you won't want to take them on and they might not want to take you on. You might say to them, you know what, if I just have a look at the medications you're on, I think that list of medications probably needs some rationalizing. If you were to come and consult with me, my primary objective would be to reduce the types of medications you're on. Are you comfortable with that? If you're comfortable with that, then let's make a further appointment. So the idea is that we book a really brief consult as our first one, 15 minutes. We do not get to the patient agenda. So we never get stuck in this consult. So as we go in, the pre-frame is our new appointments are 15 minutes only. That's just enough time to see if we align in our philosophy to health, and also if we have a problem that we can work jointly on, that we can have a good therapeutic alliance around, and then we'll make the right appointment types from there on. And so you might end up with some of these being 30-minute appointments, but they have intent. So one of those might be all around reviewing radiology. Another one might be all around reviewing the specialist letters. Another one might be all around reviewing the medications and the allergy list. But the patient is getting homework in between these visits. So you're saying, we're not doing everything now. That's completely unreasonable. And so we're just going to start with some really easy work down here. And your job is to try and find some easy wins. Sometimes they're there, sometimes they're not. I can completely acknowledge that, but we want to try and get that done. So that wasn't planned to be part of this, but I did want to give that value because it was requested earlier. So my first question is, was that useful? Just drop it in the chat. Yeah, difficult. You're right, Leah. It's not easy, but again, it's a habit. And so you can share a recording of this webinar with them. Now that brings us to the end. Before we get to the end, what I'd love you to do is just to drop in the chat for me your how useful this was for you. My mission is to be useful and to give you content that you can take away and implement. I'd love you to give a score out of 7 for how useful this was in meeting your goals for time management. 7 out of 7 means awesome. 1 out of 7 means you could have done something a lot better. Just drop that in the chat, and they will also give you a formal poll that will come by email as well with a bit more opportunity feedback. But just drop something in the chat there out of 7, and thank you all. And as you do that, I'll hand back to Trish. Thanks, Tricia.
Thank you very much. That was a wonderful hour and a half. Lovely drawing. And we can tell you're a GP because your writing's horrendous. But I could understand it. So that's the main thing. I'm just going to share my screen, if you don't mind, people, because we do have a QR code here that you can access if you wish to use that one for your feedback. We all love feedback. So please do send us feedback either through this QR code, or you will be sent the link for, or we, the link will be put in the chat and you will get an email with the link tomorrow. We'd like to thank you all for attending, of course. We will, a follow-up email will be sent, as I just mentioned, with resources and as well as a video of the recording, or a link to a video of the recording of the session. And for any future events, please visit our website. Thank you very much, everyone. We really appreciate you taking the time out tonight, and we'll see you for some future sessions, we hope. Thank you.
Thanks, Tricia. Thanks all. Go well.